Harper Audio presents The American Fisherman, How Our Nation's Anglers Founded, Fed, Financed, and Forever Shaped the USA. By Willie Robertson with William Doyle. Read by Nick Sullivan. Introduction. And God said, Let us make man in our image, after our likeness. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, King James Version. Perhaps I should not have been a fisherman, he thought, but that was the thing that I was born for. Ernest Hemingway, The Old Man and the Sea. All Americans believe that they are born fishermen. John Steinbeck. From the day America was born, fishing has been a part of the American soul. For Americans, fishing is much more than a sport. It is a lifestyle of adventure, escape, and contemplation, of peace and spirituality, and bonding with nature, friends, and family. It can be a hobby, a passion, and a full-time job. It is a way to challenge the soul, test your limits, and put food on the family table. It's how parents and children discover what they're made of together. The biblical faith that inspired America is often symbolized by fish as symbols of life, sustenance, and redemption, including Jesus Christ's recruitment of fishermen as his first disciples. The story of the loaves and the fishes, and his post-resurrection appearance to Simon Peter and the fishermen at the Sea of Galilee. George Washington was a commercial fisherman. Native Americans and European settlers were nourished on countless fish from America's lakes, streams, and oceans. Washington and Lincoln's troops were fortified at key moments by fish. A boatload of presidents loved fishing, including Chester Arthur, Grover Cleveland, Calvin Coolidge, Herbert Hoover, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Dwight Eisenhower, Jimmy Carter, and both Bushes. Great states like Massachusetts, New York, Florida, Maryland, Louisiana, Texas, California, Oregon, Washington, and Alaska were built in large part upon commercial fishing. After World War II, sport fishing rose to become a multi-billion dollar passion for tens of millions of Americans. Fishing has inspired great American literature, painting, and poetry. And fishing has directly shaped the creation, life, and growth of the United States of America. Today, fishing is America's number one pastime. There are more than 33 million fishermen and women in America. That's more than the number of people who play golf and tennis combined. Our numbers are growing fast, by 11% in the last five-year federal survey. We spend $48 billion a year on fishing gear, licenses, trips, and events. We contribute over $1 billion a year to protect the environment. In fact, American fishermen, along with hunters, are the world's most powerful conservationists, contributing billions of dollars to keep American lakes, rivers, streams, and oceans pure and safe for aquatic wildlife. We enjoy all kinds of fishing in fresh and salt water, like spin casting, spinning, bait casting, and fly fishing. Some of us even like to hunt underwater with a spear gun, and others most prefer to ice fish through a hole in a frozen lake. I can think of three things that help make America great: God, guts, and gills. The American fisherman delivers all three and is a perfect icon of the freedom, adventure, ingenuity, and devotion that define the United States of America. So come with us on a journey back to our roots, back to the rivers, lakes, and streams of our youth, back to the days when America was young, our horizons were limitless, and we were nourished by the gifts of God and nature. Come with us on a voyage into the heart of the American fisherman. Prologue, An American Fishing Family. Some go to church and think about fishing. Others go fishing and think about God. Tony Blake. In our family, there was no clear line between religion and fly fishing. Norman MacLean, A River Runs Through It. The trees, the shrubs, the flowers, the mosses, the grass, the very stones of the brook have a message for the true fisherman. There is a sermon in the stones. James Hoadley. One day when I was 12 years old, I grabbed my fishing pole and bucket and snuck off from home. I was in search of a fisherman's paradise. This could be dangerous, I thought, but I've got to do it. I walked a mile down the road along a winding creek and into the thick woods that guarded the property of Judge Harrison. He was a distinguished local justice who had a nice piece of land, and my older brother Jace and I had heard tales of a magical pond somewhere in the woods that was home to a staggering number of fish. The stories about the pond seemed too fantastic to be true. It sounded like a miracle of nature, a gift from the heavens beyond your wildest dreams of fishing, where you could fish to your heart's content and the fish would just keep on coming. The trouble was, the pond was on someone else's private property, a judge no less, and I didn't have an invitation. If I got caught, the judge might call the sheriff and I'd wind up as a condemned trespasser and fish thief. But I was young, and I guess you could say I was a trifle reckless. Nothing could stop me. I had to see that pond. I had to see if it was real, and I had to get my hands on some of those fish. The sun was burning away the morning mist on a hot, lazy Louisiana summer day, and the sounds of birds, bees, and crickets buzzed all around me as I marched through the trees with my pole and bucket. I came to a tall picket fence, threw my tackle over, and slipped under the fence. I walked down a grassy slope, and there it was, Harrison's Pond. My jaw dropped. Oh my goodness, I thought. I was blown away. It was so pretty and so secluded. It looked like not another soul had ever been there. I saw a little bridge over to the far side of the pond, a perfect spot to fish from. Just seconds after I put my line in, a good-sized bream hit my hook and a bass hit my cork. Bingo. Same thing happened again. As fast as I could drop my line down into the water, the fish just kept on striking over and over. It was unbelievable. The miracle of Harrison's Pond was true. My bucket was full in 20 minutes flat. I ran home as fast as I could to tell my brother the news. Jace, I've found the mother load of fish. We ran back to the pond and dropped our lines. Bang, 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 the fish kept striking. The buckets filled to overflowing. We caught probably over 100 fish just on that first day. We laughed, we hugged each other, we practically cried tears of joy. Before long, we were going back and forth to that pond so often that we just stashed our fishing gear at a spot in the woods. If we heard dogs barking or a truck coming down the road in the distance when we were fishing, we'd take off, run for cover, and hide. But we never saw anyone else. It was our secret fishing spot. Then one day, Jace and I went back to get our stuff, and all our poles and buckets and everything were gone. Judge Harrison had found it. We knew the game was up, and we hightailed it out of there. We had caught nearly every fish out of that pond. It was the end of the line for us. We never heard a word about it, and Judge Harrison became a good family friend. Years later, we shot some scenes for our TV show at Harrison's Pond, and the good judge was just as nice as can be. I'm still not sure if he appreciates just how many fish we swiped from his pond. If so, he's forgiven us our past transgressions. I wouldn't recommend sneaking on anyone's property, but at 12 years old, it was a lot of good, wholesome summer entertainment for us, without a doubt. In fact, that first day at Harrison's Pond was the greatest fishing day of my life. But how sweetly memories of the past come to one who has appreciated and enjoyed it from his boyhood, whose almost first penny, after he wore jacket and trousers, bought his first fish hook, whose first fishing line was twisted by mother or sister, whose float was the cork of a physic vial, and whose sinkers were cut from the sheet lead of an old tea chest. Thus rigged, with what glad anticipations of sport, many a boy has started on some bright Saturday morning, his gourd or old cow's horn of red worms in one pocket and a jackknife in the other, to cut his alder pole with, and wandered free and far by still pool and swift waters, dinnerless, except perhaps a slight meal at a cherry tree or a handful of berries that grew along his path, and come home at night weary and footsore, but exulting in his string of chubs, minnows, and sunnies, the largest as broad as his three fingers. Thaddeus Norris, The American Angler's Book. No man ever steps in the same river twice, for it's not the same river, and he's not the same man. Heraclitus. When you are on the river, ocean, or in the woods, you are the closest to the truth you'll ever get. Jack Leonard. I am an American fisherman. I fish for food, I fish for fun, and I fish for family. And I fish to honor God. The Bible specifically instructs mankind not only to enjoy hunting and fishing, but also to replenish the earth. I try to do that by fishing responsibly and ethically, and honoring the biblical instruction given in Revelation chapter 7, verse 3, "Hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees." I come from a family that's famous for duck and deer hunting, but we're fishermen too. We don't see much difference between the two. Fishing is just hunting in the water with a different set of tools and tricks. As far back as I can remember, I was deeply familiar with the joys and frustrations of fishing. Early on, my family scratched out a living just barely through commercial fishing. It was a backwoods country-style family operation, nothing fancy. Today, I do my fishing in my own state-of-the-art bass boat, all tricked out with radar, sonar, digital fish finder, depth finder, GPS, and satellite TV. But back then, all we had was my dad, Phil. Phil is the original fish whisperer, the master of all things in the water. He can just summon fish and they come up to the surface. He knows where they are, how they move and think, and how to catch them. One afternoon, when our family was all dressed up and about to go to Wednesday night church service, he said, "Hang on real quick." We watched him pull out 22 bass in the space of 12 minutes. Phil learned how to fish from his own father, and he taught me and my brothers all the basics. How to tie hooks on, how to tie the string on your pole, how to make the most of things when you didn't have many hooks and not much bait. He taught us how to use grass shrimp, worms, and wasps' nests as bait for different fish. He taught us how to drop hooks in the creek, how to fish with seine nets, milk jugs, catfish poles, and trout lines, and how and where to catch the most fish. Phil taught us how to chop up snakes and pretty much any other animal to use as crawfish bait. "Crawfish will eat literally anything," he explained. "You stand out there in the water long enough, they'll eat you, too." Every night he had us fill up a freezer with chopped-up creatures to bait the crawfish traps with the next day. The inside of the freezer was a very scary sight. "Just put a hunk of something dead in there, boys," Phil commanded. "You can pick up anything dead on the road and throw it in, too, just as long as it isn't too far gone." One day, I shot a big fat water snake and threw him in the freezer. I thought I'd put a hole in his head. I had something to eat, came back, and reached into the freezer to chop him up. To my surprise, that giant snake reared up and gave me a dirty look right in my eyes. He was alive and well. I guess I'd just knocked him out with a flesh wound. Luckily, he was in that freezer for a while, so he wasn't as lively as he normally would have been, and he didn't bite me. I shot him again and chopped him up into 12 pieces, enough for a dozen crawfish traps. It got scary when you pulled up the crawfish traps, since there was no telling what might be in them. One time we pulled up a trap and there was a big green slimy river eel in it. My brother Jason and I kept grabbing this eel and trying to hit him with a paddle, but he kept sliding away, So I got the clever idea I was just going to bite his head to make him settle down. I'd always watched my dad crush the skulls of ducks with his teeth to make sure they were dead, so I figured this approach ought to work with an eel. Let me tell you something, don't ever try to bite an eel, because that slime gets between your teeth and it takes 3 days to get it out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.